Hello and welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Elbroya, and here are your local and national headlines for tonight. We hear a special message from the leader of Brighton and Hove City Council, Nancy Platts. We hear from the Green Party councillor, Martin Osborne, about Airbnb. We speak to the Cllr Heritage Foundation. We catch up with Eric Knowles from the Antiques Roadshow. We get some mental health advice from Mel Withers at the Rock Clinic. Plus, we get a personal training lesson from Natalie Golland from OTT Training. Firstly, here is a special message from the leader of Brighton and Hove City Council, Nancy Platts, who spoke to Mark Walker.
So I'm joined here today by the leader of Brighton and Hove City Council, Nancy Platts. Welcome, Nancy. It's a very challenging time in a city at the moment with the coronavirus crisis. How are you managing those competing demands? It must be quite difficult to prioritise at the moment within the council.
Well, we've literally had to turn around how we run the council in the space of, I think it was about a week to 10 days. We suddenly had to get everybody working from home. We had to improve the strength of our IT systems to enable that to happen. We've had to have really strict priorities, which has been looking after the most vulnerable people, making sure that we get people fed. We've been trying to get homeless people off the streets and into hotel rooms. All of this is to stop the spread of the virus, keep people at home and keep them safe. So, yeah, we've had loads of competing demands and priorities, but the top priority at the moment is to save life.
Yeah. What about the other messages you've got for the people of the city? Have you got a special message for the residents?
Well, the main message to residents really is the best way you can help stop the virus from spreading is to stay at home. People can go out for essential shopping, so that's food shopping, or if they need to collect some medicines or a prescription on behalf of someone else, and they can go out for some exercise. We're saying up to 1 hour a day, but when they go out, whether they go out for shopping or to help somebody else out or for exercise, they need to keep social distancing, and that means staying at least 2 metres apart from other people. And that can be very difficult, but what I've seen is really good. What I've seen out in the city are people giving each other lots of leeway, moving around, stepping back to let people pass. We are asking also cyclists and people out running to make sure they keep their distance. I think sometimes people get a bit in the zone when they're exercising. They do need to always be aware of other people's space around them, try and keep that 2 metres.
Yeah, and the communities have really come together, haven't they, in the city? We've seen the Brighton Mutual Aid and other organisations. It's really been quite uplifting, actually, witnessing that and seeing how that's playing out on the ground.
I mean, people are just being amazing. People are going out and they're wearing like protective gear and everything, and they're collecting shopping for people who can't go out. They're protecting medicines and prescriptions. They're looking after one another. And I have to say huge thank you to all the volunteers out there that are getting together and organising food parcels to be delivered, getting people shopping, to all of the local shops and supermarkets, and particularly the small businesses that have turned around their business model overnight so that they can make deliveries and operate as takeaways so that people can have access to fresh food. They've been absolutely brilliant, so huge thank you to all of them.
Yeah, just before we go, Nancy, it's going to affect, the crisis is going to affect the city in various different ways. How do you think we can get back up on our feet again once the crisis is over?
Yeah, so, I mean, our thoughts are going to start to turn towards a recovery plan. I mean, we still don't think we've hit the peak of the spread of this virus. We expected it to be peaking around this bank holiday weekend. It could still be that it's 1 or 2 weeks away. The difficulty is that there's a bit of a time lag in getting the data. It takes 1 or 2 weeks to get the data before we can see what's happened in the past. And actually then we can plot it on a graph and see whether it's going up or down or levelling off. At the moment, we don't quite know when the peak will come, but it could be in the next couple of weeks. And once we've got that over with, we can start to turn out.
Yeah. OK, Nancy, we'll leave it there for now. Thanks for your great work at the council.
And, thank you.
Yeah, stay safe and we'll catch up again soon. Thanks for talking to us today.
We now speak to the Green Party councillor for the Hollingdean ward, Martin Osborne, about the impact of Airbnb in our city. What can be done to help tackle some of the issues? Mark Walker takes up the story.
We've got a varied agenda today, but we're going to start off with Airbnb, and it's a big issue in Brighton, isn't it? Particularly the noise-related issues that come with not all Airbnbs, but some Airbnbs that kind of ruin it in a way for all the rest, don't they? So tell us about what the Green Party are going to be doing on this issue.
Well, yeah, well, it is a big issue, and it's certainly something that we've had a lot of complaints from residents for. And last week we brought an amendment to the Tech Committee, and it's also going to go to the Housing Committee later today. And we were asking for several different things. We asked for local things that, that the council can do. So we were saying that we would like to have a task force that is bringing together from different departments in the council. So that's an environmental health team, a planning officer, a housing officer, bringing them together so they can then form this task force to then investigate about what they could do, but also to advertise what actually the council has the powers to do currently, because there is things like noise abatement orders that the council can follow up on if there's noise complaints, which are a big issue. Yeah. And it is correct, there's not all Airbnbs, and also not always Airbnbs as well, because they are other providers and there are other platforms that can be used. Yeah, so there is powers there, yeah. But unfortunately there just seems to be a lack of people coming with these complaints to the council. So we are aware of them, and we do have residents that get in contact with us. Even on an individual ward base, you could probably get dozens of complaints throughout the sort of period that we are councillors for, so the 4 years. And they do accumulate, and certain wards are particularly worse than other wards. But the council can follow up on, but it doesn't really have the resources, I don't think, to really be as proactive as it wants to be. So it's generally being reactive to these complaints. But as a part of our member, we want to try and raise awareness of these processes that the council can use. And not only in terms of noise abatement orders, but there's things like community protection notices that can be brought forward. And that's more to do with antisocial behaviour. But that can happen, and that can result. Obviously, people who are coming to the city, they might be having a good time, might be having drinking or doing other things, and that might end up causing a knock-on effect in terms of not only noise, but antisocial behaviour. There's also things like waste as well that people have complaints about, and also parking issues when, say a group of 12 people come along and they bring 4 or 5 cars, then residents also have complaints about that. And that's difficult for the council to always keep a track on, but it's mainly reactive powers that we have as the council, and we would like to be a bit more proactive.
The Chailey Heritage Foundation does some very important work with young adults with complex needs. This is a particularly difficult time for charities. Mark Walker speaks to Al Carter about the organisations that work during the coronavirus crisis.
So I'm joined here today by Al Carter, who is the Sports Development Officer at Chailey Heritage. Welcome, Al. Just tell us a bit about Chailey Heritage first. Could you do some great work with young adults with complex needs?
Yeah, so we are an organisation that caters for children and adults with very complex medical needs, physical needs and learning needs. We're a non-maintained special needs school as well, so we have school environments. We're very much educational based. With the link that we have to the NHS as well, it means that we can cater for children that are kind of on that top end of that disability spectrum that would need nurse input, that probably wouldn't be able to cope in another environment. So we are that kind of area of expertise where children who, with those most complex needs, can come and learn safely, really.
Yeah. Where's your site based?
We're based just outside of Brighton, so near Lewes, sort of in between Lewes and Hayward Teeth. So we're quite rural as well. So it's a lovely location, right on the sort of foot of the South Downs almost. So very pretty.
How are you coping with the coronavirus crisis? Because obviously there's a lot of social distancing measures.
It's affected the foundation quite a lot. From a school perspective, we've stayed open as a school just because we have residential children and users on site. So we have children that live at Chailey Heritage. So therefore, we can't close. We're staying open for those children. There aren't as many of them, obviously. We've got a roughly sort of 20 students that are still coming into school. The staff that we have that would look after those children has dropped dramatically. So they're working one-to-one with those children, which is good, sort of reducing the amount of people that are coming into contact with the children. Because of their medical needs, it's very important that this is done, and this is done in a correct way. But it has it's had a big impact. It's had a big impact on the way that the day, the school day would normally run for these children. But hopefully we are still catering for their needs.
Yeah. What about the role that you do in sports as a sports development officer?
Yes, absolutely. So we would normally play a multitude of different sports, and in our sports halls, sort of quite a close confined area, that has been able, that we've had to put a stop on for the time being, rather than doing the active sports that they would do normally, to more individual based things. So they'll be going out on bike rides, they'll be doing walking, they'll be going on trike rides, things like that, to stay physically active. We know that physical activity in sport is really, really important, but we also realise that we need to, at the moment, we need to take the measures to limit the amount of contact that these vulnerable children come into contact with other people. So we do one-to-one bike rides, one-to-one walking groups at the moment.
Al, thanks for talking to us today. All the best for the future.
Thank you very much.
Cheers. Bye.
That's it for the first half. Join us for the second half for a conversation with the Antiques Roadshow Eric Knowles. Some good mental health advice and some personal training tips. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Broya. The Antiques Roadshow and Bargain Hunt TV personality Eric Knowles caught up with Mark Walker to talk about a special coronavirus initiative. Here is the report.
So I'm joined here today by Eric Knowles, from otherwise known from the shows The Antiques Roadshow and, of course, Bargain Hunt. Welcome, Eric. I know you're doing something very special for the British Red Cross, and it's going to involve your expertise.
Well, that's right. It's all to do, obviously, with COVID-19, and basically, I'm trying to avoid going bonkers because. You know, I'm one of these people, I can't sit still. And so I decided that what I would do is that I would produce a series of talks, like tutorials, not lectures. And I'm going to be covering lots of subjects which I normally do actually lecture on. And so at the moment, I'm recording pieces about Aurelien Lalique, and I've just completed one about his jewellery. I'm working on Lalique glass perfume bottles, parts 1 and 2, and then I'll just go through it and do vases, and I'll probably do sculpture and car mascots, and then I'll go on to something completely different and maybe look, well, I'm going to look at Louis Comfort Tiffany. He's operating in New York in the 1890s through to 1928. And I've got a bit of a connection there, because you probably wouldn't know it, but I'm from the Northwest. And in the town of Accrington, we have got the best collection of Tiffany glass, public collection, outside the United States of America. We've got 157 pieces up there. So I've been growing up with this stuff as a boy. And we've got some, you know, very special pieces, exceptionally rare. And so I'm going to be talking about that. I'll move into ceramics, because I'm a ceramics and glass man. I'll be looking at the work of William Moorcroft, and Walter Moorcroft, who, believe it or not, was a friend of mine. What used to tickle me, he used to introduce me as his famous friend. And I would say, oh, for goodness sake, you're the Walter Moorcroft. You know, in pottery terms, you know, he is, you know, an icon, or was, bless him, because he's now long gone. So I'm going to be looking at that. I'll be looking probably at William De Morgan, great Victorian art potter. It's all a matter of showing wonderful images, because I know that people's concentration span when you give a talk is about 3 minutes. So I'm not pushing my luck with you, Mark, here. But, you know, that is the fact. And so if you give plenty of beautiful images, and I've got thousands and thousands of images that I can call upon. I'm going to be looking at arts and crafts. I'm going to be looking at Art Nouveau, Art Deco. With the Art Deco, probably looking at people like Clarice Cliff. To be frank with you, I've probably got about 50 different little talks I could probably call upon. It's much easier giving a one-hour lecture than it is giving what you might call a 10-minute talk. I've been finding that out. What do you include and what do you not include?
Eric, thanks for talking to us today. All the best with the talks. I'll certainly be looking out for them, and we'll catch up soon. Thanks again.
Mark Walker now speaks to Mel Withers from the Rock Clinic to get some mental health advice during the coronavirus crisis.
I'm here with Mel Withers from the Rock Clinic in Brighton. Mel, welcome. I know we're going to be talking a bit about what serves as the Rock Clinic offers in terms of counselling and psychotherapy, but just tell us a bit about yourself first and what you do in your role.
I'm the clinical director of the Rock Clinic, which I've run for 30 years, and I'm also a practitioner, so I'm a counsellor, a counselling psychologist and a psychotherapist. I also do a bit of training and consultancy, things like that. So, yeah.
Mm. Yeah. And what services do you offer at the Rock Clinic? Because it's quite a well-known establishment in Brighton. It's been there for quite a while as well.
It has. I mean, we offer a range of counselling and psychotherapy modalities, usually the ones that are well-researched, not the ones that are the more kind of fly-by-night or recent developments. We also offer a training programme, so we take trainees mostly from Brighton University, and then we have an additional placement for people who are recently qualified. So that means we can offer a four-tier service in terms of cost, which makes us very affordable for local people, because obviously private counselling and psychotherapy can be extremely pricey for people.
Yeah. Are you finding your services quite in demand at the moment? Because obviously with the coronavirus crisis, anyone suffering from anxiety, obviously they could be, you know, suffering from increased anxiety, but also other mental health disorders as well. You know, they could well be on the rise as well within our city and beyond.
Yes, I think that's true. We found that our referrals this year, before the coronavirus really hit, were really, really kind of going through the roof. You know, we were booked up a good 2 months ahead. And it's been difficult because we had to take our services offline for new referrals while we got ourselves mostly technologically sorted out. I think anyone with health anxiety, in a strange way though, is saying, welcome to my world. I always feel like this. I'm always terrified of germs. And actually for them, the world now feels a bit more realistic, whereas for other people who didn't have health anxiety before, they're now becoming terrified of catching it, passing it on, infecting elderly relatives or anyone with an underlying health condition. So yes, it's been really challenging for everybody. And that's before we even get to lockdown, which of course, as we all know, is very, very stressful for some people.
Yeah. And as you say, it's not just the fear of germs or fear of getting the virus. It's the uncertainty, the open-endedness of the whole coronavirus outbreak is just really unsettling for so many people.
Well, exactly, because rightly, no one has any idea when this is going to end. And there's been some sort of pressure on the government, I know, to say when they think it's going to end. And obviously, they just don't know. I think for many people, we're all thinking, oh, yeah, we can probably put up with a couple of weeks. Extend that into something looks like, you know, 3 to 6 months, and we're looking at really challenging times. And I'm not just talking about having enough loo roll or pasta or something. It's much more serious than that as to how we live our lives, how we interact with each other or not. Yes.
Yeah. Perfect. Okay, Mel, we'll leave it there. All the best for the future, and yes, we'll catch up again soon.
Finally, those personal trainer tips from Natalie Golland from OTT Training. Natalie spoke to Mark Walker.
So I'm joined here today by Natalie Golland from OTT Training, also from the Burn Up television series. Natalie, welcome. Just tell us about your organisation first, OTT, and how you're coping with the coronavirus crisis. Because obviously, you know, training, personal training's taken up, it's different now, isn't it, under these new social distancing restrictions?
Definitely. So we have obviously moved everything online, so nothing can be done outside, but you can obviously still get yourselves outside once a day. But now we've just got shorter sessions that suit you, so half an hour to an hour, and you can do them in the mornings or evenings, and you still get to go online and see everyone that you'd normally see, because often most of our classes are small groups. So there's groups of between 5 and 12 people, so you get to still see those and say hello, which is really nice. So it feels a little bit normal, even though it's slightly different. So that's good.
And what services do you offer at OTT then?
So we do personal training and also boot camp classes, which are normally all outside, but obviously they're now inside. And we also offer Pilates as well. So we've got a nice mix. We've got 7 to 8 classes a week, and they're all at local places like the Hove Lawns, Hove Park. So it's lovely. We're lucky living in Brighton and Hove, aren't we?
Yeah, exactly. So, and I know that you've got some tips as well for people that might be, you know, self-isolating inside. Because even if you are doing that, you can still stay fit, can't you, and healthy?
Definitely. There's obviously loads and loads of things online. So you can just go online and find classes to join in. And obviously, you still are allowed to go outside. So you've got that hour of exercise and just go out, you know, walk, run, bike, do whatever you can for that hour that you enjoy doing, and then use the time when you come home to stretch, do some weights if you've got some, or just do a class online so you can still be very fit.
Yeah, and I know you're going to provide us with some tips for exercising inside. I mean, have you got any ideas of how people might want to, a starting point for people watching?
Yeah, so it depends on what space you've got. So obviously, a lot of us in Brighton Hove live in flats, so you're not going to want to be jumping around so that your neighbours can hear you. So you want to look for maybe a class that you're laying down a little bit more or standing on the spot a little bit more. And I think it's also really important to stretch, because we're all sitting down a lot more, sitting on your sofa. So you need to get up, open up your chest, stretch out your glutes. So that's just as important too.
Yeah, okay, Natalie, thanks for talking to us today. All the best for the future and the online training, and we'll catch up soon. Thanks for talking to us.
Thank you very much. Have a good rest of your day.
That's it for tonight. Join me for more of your local news stories tomorrow. Good night, stay at home, and keep safe.